role of nutrition, exercise, and behavior. And to give this talk, we have three distinguished speakers from Salford University. So Dr. Anna Robbins, who is the program lead of nutrition and exercise in medicine. Paul Sindall is a senior lecturer in exercise science. And Phil Gray, lecturer in exercise and health psychology, University of Salford. Please.
So good morning, everyone, and welcome to our talk, which we've entitled Controlling the Controllables, Is It Enough Tackling Childhood Obesity? So I think Siva's introduced the team, so I'll move on from there. We collectively run a program at the University of Salford called Nutrition and Exercise as Medicine. Thanks very much, by the way, for inviting us to speak on this really important topic. We think it's really, really important that we make a difference in this particular area. Our intention is to run through quite a lot, really, in the next half an hour. So we've got to pack quite a lot in, really, I suppose. Initially, we'd like to provide a basic content kind of context, if you like, and some kind of overview of the area. We are going to present a case study example, which we think will make the issue kind of more meaningful in terms of a real life situation. We're going to talk about barriers and application of behavior change theory. We're going to talk about a school-based intervention that we have data from, which we think will be quite helpful. And we intend to summarize the things that we would like to see happen, really, between the people involved in the group. Obviously, Debs has just mentioned that everybody plays a role, and that's central to the message that we're going to send. We've got to do that in 30 minutes, so the pressure's on. Next slide, please. Okay, so I always like to start these kind of conversations as a physiologist, and it really is very straightforward if we balance intake and expenditure appropriately, or so we might think. Fundamentally, weight management is about balancing these two elements, making sure that we get the right balance between intake and expenditure. Whilst this is not a science lesson, this is kind of the basis by which we would operate. Next slide, please. Just to show it kind of schematically, obviously the difference is if we're able to unbalance that energy equation in some way, we'll get a meaningful result. Obviously, the reason why we're talking today about this issue is that some kids, certainly in deprived areas, as I mentioned in the previous conversation, get this balance wrong for lots of legitimate reasons, and their intake outweighs their energy expenditure. So we get this kind of excess energy building up, or as we call it scientifically, a negative energy balance, which is what we don't want, because ultimately those excess calories will be stored on the body as fat tissue, which increases health risk, as we all know. Next slide, please. So the intention really, very simply, is to increase energy expenditure, drop intake, or do a combination of those two things. And should we do that, then we have a meaningful outcome, and the problem goes away, or so we would think. Next slide, please. So what you'll start to notice now is if we try and understand the problem a little bit more closely and carefully, you'll still see energy balances at the front and center of this particular slide, but it becomes harder to see. It kind of drifts into the background. And the reason for that is because, as we all know, really, it's not just a matter of energy balance. It's very complicated. And the whole notion of balancing intake and expenditure is wrapped around by this positive feedback cycle. So to use a kind of abstract analogy, if you get a fire alarm that goes off, people think there's a fire and that causes panic and they start to run. And the very action of people running causes more panic and more people start to run and so on. And the problem escalates. So over the course of that cycle, we get greater disturbance, which is caused by that original incident or event. Obviously, an individual with a weight problem is going to be manifested with low energy levels, and breaking out of that cycle has got to be a conscious decision, really. And it is complicated to break out of that kind of lifestyle cycle, if you like. Not straightforward at all. But unfortunately, that's not the end of it, because it's even more complicated than that. Next slide, please. It becomes so complicated that we can't even make sense of it, because the detail, the granular detail in there, is almost impossible to see. So what we really need to do is intervene. If we could have the next slide, please. in much broader, widespread areas that cut across everything that we do, really, from the things that we like to talk about, which is the kind of individual physiology and biology, to the more complicated aspects, which are perhaps infrastructure, so society, culture, the way that food is advertised, manufactured, the kind of activity options that individuals have. Basically, what we're looking at there is a tremendously complicated map of barriers. And the intention is to try and find ways across, you know, groups of like-minded people, such as ourselves, as to how to break that down. Now, obviously, there's overlap. We can see overlap across some of those areas, but these are discrete entities in themselves that we need to make a difference in. So that leads us on quite nicely to talk about an individual. If we could frame the next part of the conversation based on our case client, Phoebe. Next slide, please.
So this is Phoebe. She's 10 years of age, which puts her into year six. She's very overweight, and UK statistics show that 14% of year six are overweight, alongside an additional 20% of year six are obese. So here's Phoebe's family, mum, dad with the younger brother. As you can see, they're all overweight. Dad is a security worker. Mum's not working, she's at home. Next slide, please. The Phoebe and her family align with this type of cluster, which is called an inexperienced cluster. So as you can see here, it highlights key characteristics and also highlights the tasks that both communicators and health professionals face in persuading families such as this to change their behaviours and attitudes. So we've got fairly young parents lacking knowledge and parenting skills to implement a healthy lifestyle. We've got fussy kids relying on convenience foods. They have no interest in increasing activity levels because they perceive their children to be active, which highlights a huge issue of denial. Weight status, they're all overweight. They fail to recognize child's weight status, again, denial. They're young and they've got a low income. Intent, what's their intent to change? Well, currently low because they lack knowledge, but they're willing to accept perhaps when alerted to those particular risks. So the potential task would be increasing understanding of risks of current lifestyle and develop parenting skills. Next slide, please. So as Paul's alluded to already, the reason she's overweight is because there's a massive imbalance between energy intake and expenditure. But the reasons for that are numerous, as we've already, other presenters have already highlighted today. So for Phoebe, it could be possibly not her knowledge, but maybe parents' knowledge of the reasons why she's putting on weight. Maybe cooking skills, maybe the fact that we've now got 24 access to fast food. Sedentary behavior, could be that they express time as an issue. It's likely that they're eating badly. Might be linked with income. And as the cluster indicates, this type of family appear to be unaware of the risks. Next slide, please.
Okay, so a lot of the factors which Anna has mentioned there can be placed within models such as this depicted on the screen, the COMB model. So according to the COMB model, it suggests that behavior is a function of three proximal determinants. So capability, which can be divided into the physical capability. So in terms of skills, which Anna's previously mentioned, having good fitness and stamina, strength, balance to undertake a behavior, and then psychological capability as well. So knowledge and understanding to undertake that behavior. Also the opportunity as well. So the physical opportunity, as Anna's alluded to, around time issues, but also access to facilities to be able to exercise, facilities to cook, and also land use and local infrastructure and things like that. And also the social opportunity as well. So consider social and cultural norms in this respect. And then we've got motivation as well. So this could be reflective motivation. So in terms of weighing up the pros and cons of that behavior and the outcome expectancies, and also automatic motivation as well. So think of impulses, desires, emotional reactions and things like that. So what the model suggests that these three things have to be in tandem for behavior to occur. But consider Phoebe for a second. She might have high levels of motivation, they incorporate 5 portions of fruit and vegetables into their diet. She might even have the knowledge and understanding and capability. But if she lacks that opportunity, for example, if her parents don't actively go out and buy fruit and vegetables and incorporate that within their weekly shopping routine, she's not going to undertake that behavior. And if that opportunity is restricted, it's going to decrease the motivation perhaps, and also decrease that capability and skills. Next slide, please.
So what we're currently faced with is things like this, which as a nutritionist annoy me no end. So you go into a coffee shop and you're faced with a plethora of unhealthy foods. You even go into the University of Salford, might I add, and be faced with king pot noodle for £1, together with the illustration on the right-hand side, which is increasingly annoying because you've got giant Yorkshire pudding wrapped with a drink for £5. And on the right-hand side, love your heart. So big discrepancy between those two things. And love your heart, the fruits that are available there aren't actually available in the canteen. Next slide, please. So what we want is for people, as Phil's expressed there, that if they do have the motivation and they do know what they should be doing, that they have the opportunity to do that. So they are therefore faced with, if they want to make healthy choices, they can actually do that. And this is what we need to strive towards. Next slide, please.
Okay, so this slide shows us really nothing new, and some tongue-in-cheek examples of the activity environment at present. Essentially, there is a serious undertone to this. So if we start in the top left-hand corner, it's practically impossible, unless you know, and I do know, how to get from the main concourse at Manchester Piccadilly Rail Station to platform 13 to go north without using this device that walks for you. This, of course, makes perfect sense to the railway station, who are interested in moving people through the station, you know, in a timely manner. And in some respects, helps people with movement and repair impairments and restrictions. However, I would argue that those people, I would like those people to move to develop their fitness and reduce their risk of developing chronic conditions. So you have to work hard to find decent activity options. If you look at the top right image, we've got the example of interval training at its best. So it's the mount, dismount, mount, dismount, mount, dismount cycle lane, which involves the council departments not speaking to each other effectively in order to generate, you know, quality infrastructure to enable active transport. We obviously have too many cars on the roads, and some work has been done on that in recent years. However, we still have individuals using a car as their main form of transport. And it does relate back to Deb's point, which was alarming about kind of, you know, 5 times more likely to become obese as an adult when you're an obese child. If the obese child, you know, everywhere they go is in the car, it's always going to feel natural for them to take that option. So lots of work to do there. Just to finish off on that slide, in the bottom corner, we have what looks like a very artistic structure, which is at the University of Salford. It's on the Peel Park campus. It's actually, even though it's part of the arts and media facility, it's actually a climbing wall, and it was put there as part of an attempt to make or develop an active campus, yet nobody uses it as a climbing wall. So there's lots of messages there about how we promote physical activity, or how we hide the fact that physical activity could be a natural and obvious choice. Next slide, please. So really what we're looking for is this kind of thing. I remember when I was a kid and we used to go out playing football all the time and playing sports, and we've lost that. Obviously, to change that behavior is an incredibly complicated thing, which cuts across society. So it's not just about practitioners working harder, which is what I think sometimes we make the mistake of doing, is putting the onus on them to kind of take more people, help more people. It's more about larger scale societal changes, really. Next slide, please. So this would be great. This focuses on cycling, obviously. Proper infrastructure, proper cycle lanes. Almost the cars are in the minority. Wouldn't that be a nice thing? So people feel comfortable and safe to cycle to and fro, maybe backwards and forwards, from and to work. Kids, you're able to send your kids on a bike to school without having to worry. Obviously, the issue with that is proper cycle lanes, but also things like street lighting and proper bike storage facilities, changing facilities, and those kind of aspects as well. Next slide, please.
So what we want then overall is the goal, and a couple of speakers this morning have already mentioned this. We want the goal to be able to ultimately enable facilitators on the left-hand side, as mentioned on the left-hand side, to outweigh barriers to healthy lifestyles. So on the left-hand side, we've got practitioners doing what they do and trying their best to make the change. But we need the added weight of the policymakers on the right-hand side to make this change happen and happen as quickly as possible. Over to you, Phil.
Okay, next slide, please. So in terms of health behaviour, the determinants are multifaceted, and as practitioners, we probably have the greatest influence over the first three inner rings, whereas policymakers perhaps have the greatest influence over the outer two. So what it suggests that there's individual psychology involved in terms of promoting motivation, attitudes, beliefs, knowledge, the wider social context in terms of influence of friends and family, parents and older siblings and things like that, the organisational structures, in terms of schools, for example, whether they incorporate a sufficient amount of physical education, whether they adopt initiatives such as the Daily Mile, the physical environment, so access to parks, for example, that are clean and safe, roads that have minimized traffic, crossing points, for example, to encourage active travel to and from schools, and then all sits within the wider policy context as well. So what I'm going to do now is outline a brief intervention that we delivered both staff and our students at the University of Salford to try and change health behaviours amongst year five pupils. Next slide, please. So we delivered this intervention in Trafford. There are some practical issues there as well in terms of getting access to the school, but also we noted children in Trafford, around about a third are currently overweight, are obese, and about only half are sufficiently physically active. And if we look at the figure on the right here, we can see that there's insufficient activity both within and outside of the context of the school. And I'll get onto that point a little bit later. The school itself was in the Longford ward, which was quite a highly deprived area and also high levels of Black, Asian and minority ethnic pupils as well. And as alluded to earlier, one of the key drivers of health behaviours is deprivation. I mean, for example, the individuals who are in the highest levels of deprivation are about 50% more likely to engage in less than 30 minutes of physical activity than those in the highest, sorry. Okay, next, please. Okay, so our intervention itself was based upon psychological theory. So the module that we were delivering at the University of Salford tried to teach the students about the theory of planned behaviour. So why theory itself? Well, firstly, it can identify what the target. So we can see here, for example, with the theory of planned behaviour suggests that we promote motivation or intention by changing children's attitudes, also through the influences of significant others, and also heightening control over that behaviour as well. So maximising the facilitators and minimising the barriers. And we know from research that theory-based interventions are generally more effective than those that are atheoretical. And also allows us to demonstrate the mechanisms of behaviour change. So if you deliver an intervention which is atheoretical and you get some positive outcomes, it's kind of unclear of how that outcome came about. Whereas with theoretical-based interventions, the mechanisms of change are clear. So why the theory of planned behaviour in particular? Well, there's a range of different theories that you could incorporate interventions and base them on. So the theory of planned behaviour, why we chose that was practical considerations, is what our students were learning about. And it's also reasonably good at explaining motivation and the children's physical activity behaviour as well. Next slide, please. So we did a literature review prior to the delivery of the intervention to see what aspects and key components of the interventions that would work. So we know that multi-component strategies work. So not just focusing on the individual, but also the wider social context and the organisational and institutional context, which I outlined in the previous slide. And the key aspect was parental involvement as well, given the influence they have over health-related behaviours. And we noted from some research depicted on the right-hand side here that some children, and I stress that some children may engage in compensatory behaviours. There's a high level of variability in regards to this. But we can see here on the graph, there's two different schools, one in the red, one in the blue. And the school in the blue engages in more levels of physical activity during the school day. But there's these compensatory behaviours both after the school. You can see after 3 p.m., physical activity declines in comparison to the school that has less physical education. And that's also true for the weekend as well. So this, there was this need for this whole school approach. So promotion of physical activity both within the school and outside of the school context as well. And we also took on board the fact that exercise habits take about 6 weeks to form according to the research. And again, there's a degree of variability with that as well. And what we did as well from the literature, we identified a range of different behavior change techniques from Mickey's taxonomy of 93 behavior change techniques and tried to incorporate that within the intervention. Next slide, please. So what we did is one mode of delivery for these behavior change techniques was providing the children with manuals and booklets, and it provided them with information about the health consequences of physical activity and also healthy eating, but that was framed positively as well. So it wasn't negative message framing. And we know from research that messages which are framed positively are more likely to bring about behavior change. We also gave them different physical activity options and methods of getting more active. We gave them information on the Eat Well guide and also the traffic light system. We encourage problem solving by getting them to work with their parents to do simple swaps in their diet and also look at some barriers, the activities and solutions to overcome them barriers. We also encourage them to get a little bit of social support by being active with parents and friends. Next slide, please. We also took part in the Healthy Hearts workshop. So this was facilitated by Lancashire County Cricket Club at Old Trafford. So the children went to Old Trafford, they took part in this Healthy Hearts workshop. And again, the benefits of healthy eating was incorporated within that workshop, but it also gave an instruction and demonstration on how to prepare healthy snacks and meals. And they were given time to practice that as well during the workshop. Next slide, please. So it was a range of different intervention methods that we used as well. So we incorporated additional physical education sessions. And the key aspect of this was not just the additional time, but also the quality of that time as well. So we tried to maximize the amount of time which the children engaged in moderate to vigorous physical activity. And we know that that's not always done within physical education session. There may be an emphasis on skill-based fitness rather than health-related fitness and increasing cardiorespiratory fitness. So we got some of our students to deliver them sessions and maximize the amount of time in moderate to vigorous physical activity. Importantly, what we also did was we encouraged self-monitoring of behavior as well. So self-monitoring is really, really important. You need to be aware of the amount of physical activity in your current dietary intake to be able to benchmark it against what's required and expected as per the guidelines. It also enables you to set goals and sort of monitor your progress towards them goals as well. So we provided the children with pedometers and a means of self-monitoring and recording the steps that they took per day. But importantly, what we did was we didn't prescribe specific physical activities. They were asked to increase their step in count, but whatever means that they chose, they were free to do whatever. So essentially they took ownership of it and they had autonomy over that. And lastly, and I think most importantly, there was parental involvement as well. So looking back to the theory of planned behavior that I explained in the previous slide, the subjective norms and the influence of others is really, really important for this age group. So we tried to get the parents involved. We provided them with a means of monitoring their self-monitored physical activity, provided them with diaries and pedometers. And we also gave them persuasive messages to try and increase their physical activity and health eating. Next slide, please. So some of the results actually shocked us. So in terms of physical activity, the intervention group increased the amount of moderate to vigorous physical activity they were doing per day by approximately 15 minutes. They increased their fruit and vegetable consumption by a portion. They increased their cardiorespiratory fitness, which is denoted here by the step-up test, so a decrease in score in the step-up test in terms of beats per minute. They increased their attitudes towards physical activity and health eating. and which I'm quite proud of as well, that translated the increases in self-esteem. But what was even more remarkable was that this follow-up period was during Ramadan, which a lot of the children were practicing as well. So they still increased physical activity, still increased fruit and vegetable consumption. So that's something which I was very proud of and very proud of my students for achieving. Next slide, please.
So in the interest of time, we'll just offer a quick and short summary, really. Two slides on plan of action. Now, this is an adapted spiral of inactivity, so it's by no means an exhaustive list. So there are other elements that could bring to bear on this, and it's certainly not as easy to fix these problems as it sounds, or we might make them sound. Obviously, what we can see on the slide is the problem gets worse as we head down that spiral, and it relates back to some of the things that we talked about before in terms of vicious cycles and vicious circles. We can intervene, obviously, a lot of the time. If we could just pick up on a few of these points. So, for example, lack of awareness on what to do and how to do it. If we could just jump to the next slide, please. If we had more skilled professionals, so more practitioners available to educate and inform individuals to make better choices, that would be a positive step. The other element is to provide more robust evaluations to enable quality data to be collected. So the kind of data that Phil's presenting there to enable us to make decent policy decisions at a kind of higher level. Sorry, could we just go back a slide again, Jack, please? Just to pick up on another point in terms of taking the lift or easy option. So an exercise within the exercise domain, physical activity domain, can we change things in terms of the way that buildings are structured and the environment is structured to make people make more obvious choices easier that are more conducive to physical activity? So instead of making lifts front and center, can we put a set of stairs front and center? So people are more likely to take that as the option. And there are a number of options even within our university where individuals don't use the lift because they just don't know it's there, but they do use the lift because it's the more natural and obvious choice. If I don't know if Anna would just like to pick up on a couple of the facts relating to nutrition just to round off.
Well, so if we just pick up on a couple of the nutritional things also here, I know work is being undertaken in terms of food manufacturing and changing this, but you know, they're very small changes that have occurred. This needs to happen on a much larger scale and more diverse across food products. Poor food choices that are being made don't help. If we could just flip to the next slide, please, and how that's combated. Perhaps we offer more cooking skills to educate about the importance of food and what that food contains and its benefits to health. And perhaps on a policy change and lobbying, let's change things like let's reduce the access to fast food and poor choices for food, and allow when people are out and about that they can actually, should they want to choose and they need to choose, there is actually the opportunity for them to choose healthier options. So I think all in all, if we're all happy, I know we've probably exceeded our time by a few minutes. Thank you for listening to our presentation, and we look forward to working with you in the future.